Hi, welcome to Exploring Sunday's Scriptures. This is coming to you if you're tuning in on Tuesday, November 16th, or could be any time after that. I think a little more light is necessary for me, and that helps me at least to see all of you a little better. So these are Exploring the Scriptures we will hear this Sunday, which is the last Sunday in the liturgical year. Technically, the church calendar begins with the beginning of Advent, and so this Sunday would mark New Year's Eve, I guess you would say, in the sense of the liturgical calendar, the final Sunday of the year before we move into a new liturgical year. We're moving out of year B and into year C. For those churches that follow the discipline of the lectionary all year long, this then marks the shift out of Mark's gospel and into a different gospel as the main focus through the next year. We kind of bounce back and forth. I use the lectionary as the bridge between times when we are doing a specific series or focusing on different things. We have been with the lectionary now for some time, and through Advent, we'll be moving into a series which corresponds to the themes of the Advent wreath alongside of some very specific passages that also link in with those themes of hope, peace, joy, and love. Now, Christ the King Sunday is always the last Sunday of the liturgical year, and it has with it as a unique Sunday, unique scriptures accompanying it. So we move away from hearing from Mark's gospel, as we have the past couple of weeks, and into hearing from John's gospel. John's gospel is almost exclusively used in special moments of the year like this. It is never one of the main gospels used throughout the year, as in year A, B, and C. There are four gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, John being the fourth. And so John often comes in at times like this, or in other occasions, such as John's prologue or prolegomena, as in the season of Christmas. So we often find John coming at unique moments of the year rather than on the green Sundays. So if you mark the passage of liturgical time with color, specifically looking at the color of the stole that I wear or the paraments in the sanctuary, that can help you to differentiate of the different seasons that are going on. Christ the King Sunday is a departure from green and into white as a last celebration before we enter an introspective and dark season, one of the two penitential seasons of every year, the season of Advent. Advent traditionally was a dark purple or violet color, and more contemporary, it is acknowledged with a darker blue color. Then we go to white for the season of Christmas before we go to green, the beginning of the normal time or ordinary time or kingdom tide, as it sometimes can be called. We remain in green up until we arrive in Lent. We return then to the dark introspective colors. Lent is continues to be marked out by the color purple or violet. Before we go to an absence of color, after the sanctuary is stripped on Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, it is a bare sanctuary or an absence of color or black. And then Easter, we enter a season of Easter for 5 weeks when it turns white before Pentecost and red and then back to green. So the focus of Christ the King Sunday is marking that we acknowledge that Christ is the King, the one that rules over the realities of our life, the affections of our lives, the ones that we want to align our hearts and minds and lives and living with. Now, why now? Because as we enter Advent, we already know of the historic first coming of Jesus. We are awaiting that second coming of Christ, and Christ the King Sunday is our leaning ahead and toward that time, our getting ready, you could say. And so the scripture readings and focus of this service tends to be around that truth, and in some ways our acknowledgement as that is our truth that we are waiting for. So let's get on to the readings for this week. As usual, I have them in two translations, and we'll just see how we make along. If you joined me last week, or if you were in worship, you might recall how we heard the very first chapter of Samuel. This is in some ways that circularity of the liturgical year, that Jesus is descended from the house of David. And so having Samuel come into the picture is the person, the prophet, the holy man who coronated David, who became the great king that was remembered by Israel. And so we come right back down to this root of Jesse, you know, from the stump comes forth Jesus to connect us into that history, which was so important. We now jump ahead from 1 Samuel to 2 Samuel and continue that story, skipping over great big swaths of it on Christ the King Sunday. And you'll quickly figure out where we are. In one translation it has here, the New Revised Standard, it even entitles this section that I'm going to read from, The Last Words of David. So we move from Samuel as one who was prayed for by his mother Hannah. And then if we read more of Samuel's story, we would learn that as a young boy, she followed through on her promise to commit him to the service of God. And then, of course, he comes later to anoint David. Now to these last words of David. Now these are the last words of David. The oracle of David, son of Jesse, the oracle of the man whom God exalted, the anointed of the God of Jacob, the favorite of the strong one of Israel. The Spirit of the Lord speaks through me. His word is upon my tongue. The God of Israel has spoken. The Rock of Israel has said to me, one who rules over people justly, ruling in the fear of God, is like the light of morning, like the sun rising on a cloudless morning, gleaming from the rain on the grassy land. Is not my house like this with God? For he has made with me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things and secure. Will he not cause to prosper all my help and my desire? But the godless are all like thorns that are thrown away, for they cannot be picked up with the hand. To touch them, one uses an iron bar or the shaft of a spear, and they are entirely consumed in fire on the spot. All right, for just an alternative reading from the Message of the same passage, these are David's last words. The voice of the son of Jesse, the voice of the man God took to the top, whom the God of Jacob made king and Israel's most popular singer. God's Spirit spoke through me. His words took shape on my tongue. The God of Israel spoke to me. Israel's rock mountain said, whoever governs fairly and well, who rules in the fear of God, is like first light at daybreak without a cloud in the sky, like green grass carpeting the earth, glistening under fresh rain. And this is just how my regime has been. For God guaranteed his covenant with me, spelled it out plainly, and kept every promised word, my entire salvation, my every desire. But the devil's henchmen are like thorns, cold and piled as trash. Better not try to touch them. Keep your distance with a rake or a hoe. They'll make a glorious bonfire. So David's final words. Now it's interesting, David is remembered and regaled, of course, in the history of Israel as the great king who unites the two kingdoms together. But one of the things, and pushes the Assyrians out, so much is contained within David. Most of the Psalms are attributed to David, and a whole lot of other things. One of the interesting things is David is far from perfect. Of course, we have the episode with Bathsheba and other episodes like that, which certainly show that he has the same compulsions in his human heart toward wrongful thinking and wrongful doing at times as he follows his own self-interest. But his last words here, so his last will and testament, if you will, are a reflection that he has tried within his life to allow God's word to speak through him as it has spoken to him. And part of his interpretation of that word speaking through him or living through him is that he has tried to be fair in his governance. So as a king, he has tried to rule justly or with equity. And that ultimately allows peace. The visions that are given of a sunrise or green grass with the rain still on it is simply one of peace and harmony. That when you follow or adhere to God's ways, peace and harmony can be the way of the land, can be the way of the people. And it's sort of his own accounting in his own mind and his own imagination a little bit of, is this not the case? Wouldn't you agree, or can't you see that this is the case? Is not my house like this with God? And sort of then his legacy of, as I have done that, now I leave it behind, sort of a prayer, if you will, that God will follow the same assistance, the same oversight in what comes after him. Will he not cause to prosper all my help and my desire? So, you know, all my, everything I put my life in, will God not continue to bless? It's a statement that I think many of us would make upon the conclusion of our lives. If is the commitment of our lives, the things that we have poured our energy into, the things that we have given our lives to, that we've helped to build up, it would be our hope that they would live on beyond our own physical life, that our legacy would live on through them. There is a warning at the end of this, though, with the godless, in the sense of those who are not aligned with God. So aligned with God are those who are God-fearing or God-following, God-inspired, and those who are not are those who are not in God's presence. So he calls them the godless. The other translation called them the devil's henchmen. And what is here is a warning essentially to not get aligned with them, that they end up setting you on the wrong path. You know, they prick you with other realities. They're like thorns. Can't even pick them up. You know, in getting near the godless, they will get into you and cause you to stumble. And so best just to avoid them. Keep them away as far away as you can, because if you get anywhere near and handle them, you're going to get those thorns into your life. So the use of the spear or like iron bar is just trying to say to keep these things as far away from you and your life as you can. So it's understanding those people and ways that are contrary to God, keeping them as far from ourselves as we can, so that our lives, like David, might reflect God, so that God's words will take shape within us. And the further we can keep those things away from us that would lead us astray, that would prick into us, the more that will ring true for us. And so, you know, this is certainly a great thing to be reflective of as we enter a season of consumption. A season of Christmas is often one of overindulgence and consumption. As we continue in a time in which there is so much fractioning of our culture and society, whether it be over vaccination or political alignment, that these are thorny things. And that is not how God's people are. God's people perceive and approach the world through the word and eyes of God. Well, what are the words and eyes of God? A God who sees that all is good, a God who provides the pathway for harmony to exist. If there's disharmony, then that clearly is not God's path. And so if there are those who are causing disharmony, we do best to avoid that. Or if there are things that would cause us to be distracted from aligning our lives with God, overindulgence, then we want to get as far away from that as possible. Now let's see how this passage from the Old Testament, the last words, the will and testament of David, align with our other passages. So we shift, and as I said, Christ the King Sunday really is about the second coming. So it's trying to set us up to get us ready to make sure that the testimony of the truth about God is upon our hearts and minds as we prepare for Christ's return. And the easiest book from the New Testament where we get those kind of hints is Revelation, and that's where our reading from the New Testament comes from. I know I've shared in the past, but this is just a reminder that Revelation is John's epiphany. So this is John, like the Gospel of John and like the letters of John. This is the revelation of John. So this is the vision that John has. This is the religious experience that John has. And then he writes down what he sees and experiences and hears to the best of his ability. And so we have a lot of this imagery that's very vivid. And it's when you're trying to get a handle on something indescribable, you grasp for the best words and descriptions you can. And so we read not from Revelations, but John's revelation. And this is from the very beginning, the first chapter, four verses, verses 4-8. Again, I'll read two translations. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and on his account all the tribes of earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Here's the other translation. I, John, am writing this to the seven churches in Asia province. All the best to you from the God who was, the God who is, the God who was, and the God about to arrive, and from the seven spirits assembled before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, loyal witness, firstborn from the dead, ruler of all earthly kings. Glory and strength to Christ, who loves us, who blood-washed our sins from our lives, who made us a kingdom, priests for his Father, forever, and yes, he's on his way. Riding the clouds, he'll be seen by every eye. Those who mocked and killed him will see him. People from all nations and all times will tear their clothes in lament. Oh, yes. The Master declares, I'm A to Z. I'm the God who is, the God who was, and the God about to arrive. I'm the sovereign strong. So you can hear in that those hints towards second coming. Now, the revelation is written as a letter. And some of what we have here is the formula that goes into the letters of that time. We don't have the very beginning of it, but we have the conclusion of some of that formula that we can hear very common in Paul's epistles as well. So what does that formula have? It has who's writing the letter, who is being written to, and then a word of thanksgiving, some sort of opening greeting before the body of the letter has gone into. So, who's it written by? John. Who's it written to? The seven churches in Asia. Then we have that thanksgiving piece. Grace and peace to you from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. That's pretty much the thanksgiving. We might be able to tack in what follows as well as part of the thanksgiving, but we start to make that bridge from that. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. It's because of that amen, which is there in the earliest versions of this. Now, amen simply means so be it. So it's not a statement. When we make a prayer, we really do think of amen as being the conclusion to a prayer. The word itself means so be it. So at the conclusion of this thanksgiving that John is writing, He is saying, so be it. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood and made us to be a kingdom of priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. So be it. So it's a statement about to him be the glory forever and ever. Let this be the case. You know, so be it. So it's a very strong statement when we see that interspersed in things like this. So I probably, based on the fact of the presence of that amen, that so be it, would include that second paragraph as well, that second piece into the thanksgiving that John writes to those seven churches in Asia that he's writing this revelation to, that he's sharing this experience with. Now, some of this goes into some very basic theology that we might just gloss over, again, just looking at this as part of the formula of letter writing, such as a sense of the presence of God that has been since the very beginning, was, so we from him who is, was, as has been from the beginning, is, continues to be present and alive. And then finally, yet to be, if you will. The one translation has it as, and the God about to arrive. There's that sense of the impending coming or return of Christ, which the early church certainly had this expectation that it was going to happen at any moment. And perhaps because it didn't happen so quickly in that first and second century early on in the church's life, we've got a little way too far relaxed in not thinking critically about Christ's return, that we should be ready at any time. And letters like this certainly are that sense that the arrival could happen at any time, about to arrive. You know, we could try to translate about, but we don't know what is about in God's eyes versus ours, or God's time versus our time. What else do we have here theologically? We have reference, of course, to Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the witness to God's truth, the firstborn from the dead, resurrection, and ruler of the kings of the earth. So overseer of everything that is. We have more in the theology. What did Jesus do? Loves us, freed us from sin. How did he do that? By the offering of himself, through his agape love, the self-sacrifice, the giving of himself for others, even though it was undeserved or unwarranted. And by virtue of that, that has then ordained, created a priesthood of all believers. So we all have this responsibility that we bear in the temple that is not only our lives, but of the world, to be involved to serve God, as that's what priests did, is serve God. We do that as well. All right, now let's shift into that second half of this. This is the beginning of his revelation, of his witness of things. Look, he's coming. He's coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierce him. On his account, all the tribes of earth will wail. The other one was, riding the clouds, he'll be seen by every eye. Those who mocked and killed him will see him. People from all nations and all times will tear their clothes and lament. Oh, yes. So it's be on the watch. He's coming, going to come down from heaven, and everyone will experience and see this truth. This section also ends with a, so it is to be, amen. So it is to be, so be it. The other translation translated it, oh yes, so be it, has much more force to it. And then finally, what this one coming on the clouds is going to speak. So we don't have here, and he will say, but that is what is intended. I am Alpha and Omega. I was in the beginning. I'm going to be in the end, A to Z. I'm at the beginning, end, and everything between, says the Lord God, who is, who was, who is to come, which is kind of a repetition of that same thing. I am the beginning, I'm the end, and everything in between. And that ends the passage. So, links to Samuel, it's a little loose to find the links. Again, the overarching theme is is the words of God being upon our heart and mind, us being priests of that word, or being the ones that are ushering that in, or speaking it, or making that truth known. Let's see what John's gospel has for us and see if that might be the glue that manages to connect all these pieces together. This is from the episode of the crucifixion, so we're starting right here at the end of the story. So let's see what we have here. And Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I'm a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." We'll go to the other translation. Pilate went back into the palace and called for Jesus. He said, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Are you saying this on your own, or did others tell you this about me?" Pilate said, "Do I look like a Jew? Your people and your high priest turned you over to me. What did you do?" "My kingdom," said Jesus, "doesn't consist of what you see around you. If it did, my followers would fight so that I wouldn't be handed over to the Jews. But I'm not that kind of king, not the world's kind of king." Then Pilate says, "So you are a king, or not?" Jesus answered, "You tell me. Because I am king, I was born and entered the world so that I could witness to the truth. Everyone who cares for truth, who has any feeling for the truth, recognizes my voice." Without getting too much into the whole scene and episode of the crucifixion, part of what Jesus has been arrested for and brought to Pilate for has to do with claiming superiority, a kingship, over against the ruling governing body of Rome. So to proclaim yourself king of the Jews would be in violation of who controlled the government at that time. So he's been brought here, he's been brought before Pilate because of this. And Pilate essentially is trying to get him to self-incrimination. "Just tell me that this is what you're saying about yourself or what you feel about yourself, and then I can execute you for this, because you're proclaiming yourself to be the head of something of which you are not." But Jesus kind of runs in circles around the answer. He doesn't say that he's not a king. He says he's a different kind of king. So it begins with, after he asks him, "Are you king of the Jews?" Jesus says, "Are you asking because you are interested, or are you asking because other people told you this?" Pilate's response is pretty arrogant in the sense of, "Look, I'm not a Jew, so how would I know if you're king of the Jews? As is your own people who've handed you over, proclaiming that this is the truth that you have promoted, and so that's why you're here." Now, Jesus goes into, "My kingdom's not of this world." So the other translation, I think, did this really well when it says, "My kingdom doesn't consist of what you see around you. If it did, my followers would fight so that I wouldn't be handed over." And I think that that just strikes a little more at the heart of what Jesus is trying to get to, is we think of kingdoms as being territorial with borders and government and governance related to those things. And Jesus here is promoting that the kingdom that he represents is not one that has those human conditions connected into it. Because if it did, then also there would be an uprising of those who would be connected into those same realities. As it is, his is without borders or boundaries, doesn't consist of what can be really seen. And his life testifies to this truth and those who belong to this truth. Well, what's some of the things that Jesus's life testifies to? That everyone is loved by God and can be forgiven. That everyone is valued by God, even those that society didn't value, Jesus touched, interacted with, connected with, embraced. That we see in John's gospel where this comes from, the great commandment that he gives the disciples is that they serve one another. And that's the truth about God that can then be seen in them. He does this by washing their feet and saying, this is what you're to be like. This is how it's to be. And so this is listening to that truth then is following through on something that doesn't ever have borders or boundaries, but it's about care of one another, a deep and committed care, because a person is a person. They're a child of God and therefore should be valued and cared for because they are. So that is different than parading some sort of nationalistic identity as the reason why you are managing something, you are doing something. I was born, I entered the world so that I could witness to the truth. There's the truth that I was speaking of. Everyone who cares for truth, that truth that his life proclaimed, who has any feeling for the truth, recognizes my voice, recognizes that as God's way, as the way, as an alternative to all of the realities that normally form us and divide us and create borders around us and divisions between us, that Jesus comes and proclaims a very different truth. Now, did I find in here the glue to really connect the three passages together? I'm going to say no. Lectionary lately has really not lent itself to a great homily or a way in which the three can come together. I kind of managed to get it there this past week in the proclamation on sibling provocation, but it's been a little bit hard, which means as a preacher in worship or planning worship, you end up kind of focusing on one over three as the place to do the most explanation and exploration of its message. Well, where would I do that this week? Now, that's a good question. I probably would not, you'll have to wait till Sunday to find out for sure, I probably would not tend to focus on the Old Testament. I think that that would be a hard place to really lean into and to find a message there that resonates, at least with where I'm at spiritually. Now, maybe it would be a good way to ready us for Advent, thinking about the proclamations of Jesus's family lineage and how that corresponds to David, how that corresponds to what David says is his last testament, how that ends up embodied in Jesus even more so, perhaps. So you could, but it's not probably where I'm going to go. Revelation? Revelation might be a good one in the sense of really thinking about Christ's second coming, answering that question about our readiness at that return. And this is where I think you could pair up two of the readings. Does our readiness testify to Christ's truth in our lives? Or do we come to church and we go through the motions, but our lives really don't testify to the truth as they should? They don't show Jesus or Jesus as our King, if you will, the one that really is leading the realities of our life, or the one who we are trying to align our lives with. So I think that there may be possibilities to kind of glue together the second and the third passage, so the passage from Revelation and the passage of John. It's hard to believe that 1 week from now, when we gather to do this, or for that matter, when we gather for worship, we'll be in the season of Advent. It just doesn't feel like to me like we're really there on the precipice of Advent again, but we are. And so we celebrate this week Christ the King Sunday. You heard David King. You heard here, certainly in the gospel, references to King and my kingdom. We celebrate that we have that leader over our life who can help us to put that truth upon our lips and that testimony in the works of our hands. I look forward to worshiping with you this Sunday. I hope this has been a good and brief introduction to these passages for this week. And I do encourage you to go back and read through them a couple more times before Sunday. I find that can be really helpful to enriching the experience on Sunday morning. And I will see you next week. Well, I'll see you on Sunday for worship, but I'll see you next week as we explore the first scriptures for the season of Advent. God bless you.